Dear students, the next topic in module 4 to study is client-server properties. What is client-server properties? Before understanding client-server property, let us study some basic. Now, let's detail some of the properties of clients and server. That are affected by the various types of IPC used between them. So let us study here. We will discuss some properties of the client and server which will be used in the IPC inter-process communication method. The simplest type of relationship is to have the client fork and execute the desired server. So here client will create a server using the fork function and it will execute it exec using the function exec. It will execute the server. For that, two half duplex pipes can be created before the fork to allow data to be transferred in both that. Now just see, this is the client and this is the server. Now client will create a server, but before creating a server it will create two pipes. Now pipe is half duplex, data can be transferred only from in one way. So but here client is trying to send some data to the server and it also server also tries to send some data to the client. So since pipe is one way communication, it cannot be possible with single pipe. So that's why a client will create two pipe here. So pipe 1 and pipe 2. So as we know that when a pipe is created, it returns two file descriptors, file descriptor 0 and file descriptor 1. So since if the client wants to write the data to the child, so it will write the data into the pipe using the file descriptor 1. And child server will have the standard input to read the data from the parent, whatever parent process, whatever it has sent. Similarly, suppose if the server wants to send some data to the parent process or client, then using pipe 2 std out, it will pipe 2 will read the data and it will send it to fd2. So fd2 file descriptor 2 of 0, it will read the data from std out. Now the server that is executed can be set user ID program, giving it special privilege. Already we had discussed about the real user, effective user ID and set user ID. Set user ID is used to give some special privilege to a process, like root privilege. So here server will be provided some effective some high privilege data. So here the server that is executed can be set user ID program and giving its special privileges. Also the server can determine the real identity of the client by looking at its real user ID. Also the server can be determined, the server can determine the real identity of the client by looking at its real user ID. Now here this is the server and this is the client. So how the server will come to know which client has sent the data, because here so many clients will be there. So server using the server can determine the real identity of client by looking its a real user ID. So here server will look into the real user ID of the client and it can determine. With this arrangement, we can build an open server. So this way, this arrangement, this server is called open server. What does open server does? It opens files for the client instead of the client calling the open function. So here the server itself will open the file for the client, and client doesn't have to call the open API or open function. This way, additional permission checking can be added above and beyond the normal Unix system. So like this, additional permission of checking can be added. We assume that the server is a set user ID program giving it additional permission. Already we did here set user ID. So if any process receives the set user ID, it gets the additional permission or special permission, that is called root permission, and it does more work. The server uses the real user ID of the client to determine whether to give it access to the requested file or not. Here server will check the user ID of the process or client, and based on that it will permit the process to access the file. This way we can build a server that allows certain user permission that they don't normally have. Client server using message queues. So here one more thing is that how a client server can use the message queue. So a single queue can be used between the server and all the clients using the type field of each message to indicate the message recipient. A single queue can be created between the server and clients. So where clients can be writing the data into the message queue and server can receive the data from the message queue. For example, the clients can send their requests with type of field 1, and included in the request must be client's process ID, because so many clients are there. So how a client can be identified? So client should send the process ID. The server then sends the response with the type field set to the client's process ID. Then the server can send the response to the since server has already received the type field of 1, so with this type field only and a client's process ID, server can respond it. The server receives only the message with the type field 1, and the client receives only the message with the type field equal to their process ID. So like this, using the message queue, a client and server can communicate with each other. Alternate method is there. Alternatively, an individual message queue can be used for each client. Before sending the first request to a server, each client creates its own message queue with a key of IPC private. So instead of like each server can also create a new message queue using the IPC private. The server also has its own queue with a key or identifier known to all clients, and this request contains the message queue ID and for server.